You really don't live until you first die. You can't be born again until you bury and crucify that old man. We're under the section now, do not love the world. Talking about not loving the world, I can't help but go to 1 John 2, verse 15 to 17. I memorized this a long time ago because to me it was such an obvious summary of what that Christian life is all about. Do not love the world or the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Can you do both? Can you love both?
No.
For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it's of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it. But he that does the will of God abides for how long? Notice there's a contrast between loving the world and the will of God. You cannot be doing the will of God and loving the world. They don't go together. James 4:4, please.
Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God.
You can't do both. You can't say, you know, there's good things in the world. I want to enjoy some of the pleasures of the world, a little bit of worldliness and a little bit of church. And typically those that are trying to ride the middle of the road are really Laodicean. They're not hot and not cold. They're just plain old lukewarm. And what does Jesus, how does he deal with Laodicea? It's nauseating. They have just enough religion to fool themselves, but not enough to save them. And in the book Steps to Christ, it says that they're really the most miserable of all people because they don't have the peace, the real peace of having a spirit-filled life, but they've got just enough self-denial where they're not really enjoying the world with both hands. And so that's why Paul says, above all men, we are most miserable if we're trying to live the Christian life and there's no eternity, if you don't have everlasting life. But you know, why does he say adulterers and adulteresses? Is he only identifying the sin of adultery? I think there's more to it than that. In the Bible, when you're baptized, you're married to Christ. And there's to be a loyalty to Christ and the things of God. If you're trying to love the things of the world, all of those things are summarized as adultery because it's a kind of spiritual adultery when you say, I'm a Christian, but you're really living like everyone else in the world. And there should be a distinction. There should be obvious differences. Your neighbors ought to know that you're different because you're letting your light shine and there's some consistency. You know, I was thinking about an illustration last night. Years ago, one of the worst maritime disasters in North America actually happened right after President Lincoln was assassinated, and almost nobody knew about it. A steamboat caught on fire and blew up in the Mississippi. And I think it was like 500 people, they never got the final tally, died in that disaster. And they were within a mile of land because it just exploded. It was dark. It was at night. There were flames. And a lot of people got on pieces of the broken ship. And they couldn't tell they were in the river because the river is moving. But when it's dark and you can't see the shore, you have no context. So they were drifting down the river, but they felt like they were standing still because all they could see was each other. And it wasn't until the sun came up they realized that they were moving 4 or 5 miles an hour. So you know what's happened with the church? Picture that you've got 100 life rafts out in a foggy river. And you look around, it's a big river. You don't see the shore, but you see all the other life rafts. You see leaves that are in the water, and they're all perfectly still. Because you're all looking at everybody moving the same speed, you feel like you're not going anywhere. But it's not until that the fog melts and you see the shore, you realize you're really drifting towards the waterfall. What's happening to the church today is we are spending so much time looking at everything that is drifting together that we don't know where we're heading. Because our point of reference is the television, other Christians, all the compromise we see in the world together is we're not looking at anything stationary. And finally, if you drift along in the river and you come to a big old rock sticking out of the water, you can see the waves pushing up, the current pushing up on that rock, and you realize, hey, we're moving. It's not the rock moving. I remember I was on Watt Avenue. I was at a stoplight. Watt Avenue, pulled up to the stoplight. I was first in line there. All the cars began to pile up around me, right, left behind me. And I look in my rearview mirror, and I don't know why he started doing it, but the man behind me had put his car in reverse and started backing up. And then I looked to my right, and the guy on the right of me had put his car in reverse, and he started backing up. And I looked to the left of me, and the guy on the left of me, he put his car in reverse, he started backing up. And I started feeling a little self-conscious, and then I looked ahead of me, and I realized I let my foot slip off the brake. I was in drive. I was going forward. Nobody was moving. It was me. And I thought everybody else was in reverse. We lose our perspective sometimes because the world is drifting further and further from God. And the church in the world, we're so in the world, we're looking around us and we think, I don't see anyone moving because we're all moving together. But if you go back and you look at what the standards of the church were 50 years ago, I know some people think it's progress that we've changed. But if you look at what the standards of the church were 50 years ago, I think you'd be shocked if you started to line some of those points up. And it happens so slowly that it's almost imperceptible. It's like when the dentist, if he's really skilled and he gives you your Novocaine, he just puts a little swab on your gum first to numb the surface of the gum, and then he puts the needle in and just goes in a little bit, and he injects a little and goes in, injects a little, goes in, injects a little. You never, pretty soon he says he's done. You didn't even feel it. If he's good. That's what the devil does. We're all being numbed by the world. And I think we need to really pray and say, all right, what is it that's stationary that we look at that isn't moving? That's the Word of God. It doesn't change. That's the rock that doesn't change. And these things that Paul identifies as the fruits of the Spirit and the lusts of the flesh, those are things that don't change. Romans 12:1-2.